yesterday, the elders met and were talking about the coming year. And, you know, of course, English ministry was also part of the discussion. And I mentioned that we did need a praise leader. And by the way, I didn't introduce Hisam because I knew his skills would introduce himself. And I didn't want to play him down in any way. And thank you for your willingness to come, you know, in your business and lead us in praise. And I could really feel your heart of worship. I don't know if you guys did as well, right? And at the same time, I was reminded of how, you know, Ben, he was leading us for for a long time, and how thankful I was for Ben, you know, and how grateful I should have been for his service here. So it's kind of late, but thank you, Ben, for serving us. And you could come time to time and repent and serve. Repentance is required. But you know, everyone is hoping that you know, Hisam would stay with us. It's really up to God, and you know, no pressure. You know, we'll just be without a praise leader, just being dry and dead. You know, there's how many of us? 30 of us. 30 souls. You know, drying out. And I'm just thankful to God. You know, and during praise and worship, just listening to the words of the song. And you know, the theme is the love of God. By the way, in case you didn't get it, the love of God. Being reminded of how much we need God's love, right? How much we need His security. We need to know that even though there are friends who let us down, there are people who let us down, the circumstances of life may let us down, but there's one person who will never let us down, right? God will never let us down. His love is enduring. It never fails. It's faithful. His love is faithful. Amen? So, the passage we read today is from Psalms, and Psalms is a book that's kind of mysterious to a lot of us, I think, because we don't read it as much, and we don't preach from it as much, but it's such an important book, and for us to understand what God has to say, I want to explain a little bit about this psalm and the book of Psalms, okay? And so, Psalms is a prayer book, okay? It's a prayer that people wrote as they journeyed with God, okay? There's 150 psalms. Some of the psalms are attributed to David. Some are attributed to Asaph, and so forth and so on, okay? But the psalms, they tell us the real life situation of the people of Israel, because it's a prayer. It comes out from their hearts. And there are five books. The psalm that we read, 107, is a part of a trilogy, meaning it's part of three psalms, 105, 106, and 107. And the Psalm 107, which we read, is the last part. The reason we know why it's a trilogy is because it's anonymous. There's no author that's attributed to these three psalms, while a lot of the psalms is attributed to David or Asaph or whoever, right? But it's anonymous. And there's a progression in these psalms, 105, 106, 107. 105, it speaks about how God promised Abraham, right, a promised land, but the people, they were enslaved in Egypt, and God rescued the people out of Egypt from the slavery. So 105, it tells the people to be reminded of what God has done in their lives and how God, in His love, rescued them from slavery. Okay, that's Psalm 105. Psalm 106 talks about how they entered the promised land, right? God brought them into the promised land. The psalmist is saying, the same author is saying, remember how God, in His love, brought you into the promised land and fulfilled the promise that God gave to Abraham, right? But then he also reminds the people in Psalm 106 how the people sinned and they were taken into exile. They didn't obey God. They obeyed the other idols and they lived as they pleased, right? They didn't listen to God's law. And so they were taken into exile. That's Psalm 106. And by the way, through all this, the psalmist is saying, give thanks to the Lord for what he has done. And what we see in these psalms is that there's the people, they make a mistake, but God is faithful to save. Okay? Now, Psalm 107, what we read, is he's talking about the exile. He's speaking to the people, right, who came back from the exile. The people were taken into Babylon, Assyria, and they were dispersed, but God brought them back to Jerusalem, to the land of Judah. And so the psalmist is speaking to that situation, in that situation. And he is saying here, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. And what he is saying is, no matter what has happened in your life, you know, you were taken into exile, there were some bad things. And even as they are back in their in the city of Jerusalem, it's not the glorious city. Their life is not as affluent as it used to be. There's been a lot of tragedy. There's been a lot of setback in their lives. And there's been a lot of worry because, you know, there's been war. Their family members have been killed or, you know, they've been in Babylon. And so they were without a home for a while. But despite all that, God's been good, okay? And his love, his love endures. And his love, it doesn't change despite your circumstances. And that's what the psalmist is saying here. And he says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from the east and from the west, from north and from the south. Now, you can imagine the people there as the psalmist is, why is he telling the people this? Because the people are still insecure. Even though they're back into, they're back home, and they're trying to rebuild their life, they're still insecure because there's been a trauma, right? Their life, it was, you know, the Babylonians came, and there was a huge war. They were taken into exile. So there's insecurity, and their future, there's worry. Right? They're worrying about their future. How are we going to make it? Are we going to have another tragedy? So in the midst of the trouble, the psalmist is telling the people this so they can move on, trusting in God's love. They can move on into the future, trusting in God's love. He's telling them to be reminded of what God has done in the past. Now, and he points to the love of God. Now, the word love here is translated as, right there, just love. But it in Hebrew, it's chesed, right? I think I've mentioned that before here. Chesed, right? Can you guys all say that? Yeah. Yeah, chesed. There's that, you have to kind of, that. Thank you, Grace, for demonstrating. It's a book. I don't know if you were trying to say it or trying to get rid of something in your throat, but yeah, it's chesed. And actually, one of my fellow students had named his daughter chesed. You know, I was like, wow, that's, you know, meaning is good, but man, the sound, I'm not sure. I'm like, congratulations, but did you know it's kind of hard to pronounce? And people are going to be like, hey, chesed. Anyway, chesed. And it means a little bit more than love. And a lot of translations say it's steadfast love. Because in Korean, it's inje. Inje. And it's not love. It's a little bit more than love. It's enduring. There's a sense of faithfulness to it. There's a sense of duty and responsibility in the love. For example, as a mother has a chesed for her children, there's a sense of loyalty and faithfulness that there's a duty to love, right? Or between best friends, okay? There's chesed between best friends. You wouldn't betray your friend, right? And so it's that kind of love of God that the psalmist is saying. You know, we'd be reminded of the chesed of God. And so what this psalm teaches us, when we look at it, and as we look at what the psalmist says, as we look at the love of God, the steadfast, faithful, unchanging love of God, there are three things. Where do we find this love? Okay? And what kind of love is it? And how can we experience it? How can we live in this love? So let's go to the first point. Where do we find God's love? Now, God's love, although there are a lot of different religions and we live in a pluralistic society with many different opinions, you know, there's one thing that many people would agree about God. If there is a God, even people who don't believe in God, if there is a God, he must be a God of love. And most people would agree, God should be a God of love. Now, where did they get this idea of God as a loving God? And, you know, you may say, well, what do you mean, where did they get it? It's common knowledge, you know. God, if he exists, he should be a loving God. Common knowledge. Is it common knowledge? Is it just passed down from generation to generation? Common knowledge. Oh yeah, God, he's a God of love. And if you look into history, you know, did it come from the ancient history? If you look in history, did it come from there? Is it passed down as a common idea? The answer is no. There's a book that was written called Idea of the Holy, and it's a study of ancient cultures. And in this book, you find a commonality in ancient cultures as people approach the divine. You don't find love toward God or of God as people perceive the divine. As they approach God, what you find is fear. There must be a mediator, a priest between people and God. So when you look into ancient cultures, there's a sense of, you know, it's you need to make a sacrifice, right? You need to please God in different ways. There are many different types of altars. And in some cultures, you know, sacrifice even people, even your own children, right? And so I remember even as a kindergarten, when I went before kind of in a sanctuary, right, in church, I went to a Catholic kindergarten in Korea. And the first time I walked into this sanctuary, it was just so holy. I mean, as a kindergartner, I just felt like there's like a divine presence here. And what I felt there was a sense of fear. Fear before a holy, holy God. Even as a kindergartner, I felt that. And growing up, whenever I thought about God, whenever I looked up into the sky, I thought about God, there was a sense of fear. So the idea that God is loving, he's all-embracing, doesn't come from, it's not common knowledge that we get from history, from cultures. It never was. Now, do we get from religions? The world really, it must come from one of the religions, and the answer is no. Okay? The idea of a personal loving God doesn't come from any of the world religions. Confucianism, there's no personal God in Confucianism. In Buddhism, right? The idea of love itself is an illusion that you have to get over, right? In order for you to enter, like, nirvana or whatever, right? Islam. Muslims, they believe that God is merciful, but you could never have a personal loving relationship with God. You know? They don't see God as a friend or as a father. He's almighty. Okay? So the idea of a loving God doesn't come from religions either. Where does it come from? It comes from the acts of God. It comes from what God has shown in history, his love, as is recorded in the Bible. The Bible is a record of God's love and how he has acted in history in his love to people. Even though people are rebelling, they're sinning, God is always seeking people out. You know, even when Adam and Eve sinned, right? And God is a just God, and he must punish sin, right? He must be just and bring righteousness into the world. He still clothed it, didn't he? Right? And as they had to leave the Garden of Eden, God He promised that he would send, right, the Savior. Right? He promised in the garden that, you know, he's going to break into history. And when you look, I think it's in chapter Genesis chapter 3, he says, the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent, right, in Genesis. And that's a promise that in humanity, God is going to come, and he's going to restore. He's going to restore what was lost in the fall of sin. So the love of God, we come to know through God's acts as it's recorded in history, as it's recorded in the Bible, okay? So if we want to know the love of God, we have to look at, you have to go to the Bible. You have to look at what God has done. That's where the idea that God is loving comes to us, okay? So now, then what is God's love like? And when we look at God, and the psalmist gives us four specific examples in which God has acted in four different types of lives. And I think these four examples represents a lot of the situations that we will face in life. So when we look at these four examples in the psalm, we see that there are three characteristics of each situation. Okay? You have a distress. You have a place that the person is in, and you have what God has done for that person. Okay? And so the first part is that the person, he's lost. Okay? This person is lost. So in verse 4, it says, some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Okay, so the first group of people, they're lost where they are. They're wandering. They can't seem to get to where they want to go. They're still searching. And in their searching, they're hungry and they're thirsting. And I think a psalmist is not only referring to physical hunger, physical thirst, physical goal, even though here he does talk about a city, right? In verse 7, he led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. It's more than that, right? People are longing, but they're wandering in this world seeking to find something more, okay? But they're not finding it. So the distress here, right? Distress, location, and God's act. Distress is they're lost, okay? They don't know where to go. The location, they're in the wilderness. But what does God do? God shows the right way, okay? God shows the right way to go. And that's what God does. And a lot of times in our lives, right? If we need something, we want something right away, you know, in our situation. But God will not give it to us. God will not give what we ask for. What he will do is he will show us the way to get it, you know? What he does is he shows us the right way, where to go. He points us into the right direction, okay? He gives us the answer because he knows. God knows how we need to get there. So that's the first example. And so God, he shows the right way. And the second example is verses 10 through 16. And here, if we look at verses 10 through 16. So can you go to the next? Verses. Okay, you don't have it? Okay. So in verses 10 through 16, they're in darkness. Okay? It says they're in darkness, right? Verse 10 says this. Some sat in darkness and the deepest gloom, prisoners suffering in iron chains, for they had rebelled against the word of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from the distress. So the distress is that they're a prisoner. Okay? They're a prisoner wherever they are. In the location they're in darkness. They're in deep gloom. Okay? And the Bible describes it as there's a bronze gate door that's blocking them from being free. They're iron bars. They're in a sense of a slavery, you know. And so God, what does he do? He frees him. for them, right? God frees them. He breaks down the chains. He breaks down the iron bars, okay? That's the second example. Third example, verses 7 to 22, is that the distress is that the people are sick, okay? And so, verses 17 through 22, read it. Some became fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquities. They loathed all food and drew near the gates of death. And so, they can't even eat because of their sickness. Okay, and again, here, the sickness that these people are in is not just physical sickness. Okay, and there's an example in the Bible where Hannah, who was childless, she was barren, right? But her rival, so her husband's second wife had a lot of children, and her rival would taunt her, and her rival would make fun of her, right? Because she couldn't bear children, and she was in such distress that Hannah, she would refuse to eat, right? So there was mental anguish, emotional. She was sick in her soul, right? And so she wouldn't eat, but she goes to pray, right, to God, and God answers, and then she begins to eat. So here, where it says, the sickness is not just physical, but it could be emotional and mental. And so, what does God do? God sends the word to heal. God heals her for him. And the last example is the distress is that there's a storm. And because of the storm, the person has lost courage. The circumstances of this person's life as he's journeying, there's a huge storm. There's a wave, and it's going up high, up and down, and he's caught in this huge storm, and this person begins to lose courage where he or she is. And so there's a melting of courage and a fear for life. And he's in this storm, and what does God do? He calms the storm. To see. When we look at these four examples, what do we learn about God's love? First, that his love, not only about his love, but who God is that God is good. His love can be characterized as steadfast love. He's good, meaning, he's for us. He's looking out for us. He's there. And so to summarize these four things, God satisfies our longings. In the first example, the people are longing to find their way. They're hungry and thirsty, but God satisfies that hunger and thirst. Third example, God is good. His love is good because why? He liberates us from what's keeping us in bondage. And a lot of people these days, I think, they're in bondage to addiction. They're addicted to something, It could be games. It could be drinking, or it could be smoking, or whatever. There's a certain addiction that people, and they're in bondage because of it, But God, he frees us. He sets us free, right? He sets us free. And so God is good because he sets us free. And thirdly, God, he heals. He heals us with his word, the Bible says. He sends his word, and he heals our hearts, when we're down and discouraged. He sends a word. And lastly, he brings us peace. He calms the storm. And so his love is good. His love is good. Secondly, we learn that when we look at these things, There's nothing that can stop God's love. There's nothing that can stop God from loving us and taking care of us. His love is eternal. His love lasts forever. And what that means, it's not just talking about the length of God's love, but it's also talking about the power of God's love. When you look at each of these examples, right, there's a storm, right, the circumstances, there's no one in this world who could intervene, but even the storms, you know, God commands. The situation, it could be a situation, it could be a natural disaster or whatever, even nature, right, nothing can stop God's love from coming to us, right? But more importantly, our sins, even our rebelliousness, does not keep from God from loving us. When you look at the third example, this is an incredible thing about God's love. It says that the people are in darkness because they have sinned. Okay? They have rebelled against God's word. So they put themselves in their situation. Okay? They didn't listen to God. They rebelled against God. They went their own way. And God put them there in the bondage of chains. God put them there as well as a just God, right? But when the people cry out, who breaks the chains and who breaks the iron bars? God does, okay? And that's an incredible thing, right? Because the bars of iron and the bronze door was set by God himself, and yet he intervenes, right? Despite the sin, to take away the iron bars and to take away the bronze door, right? So Tim Keller says this about God's love, his eternal love, his powerful love, that nothing can keep God's love away, even when we run away from God. Even our sins, God is able to overcome that, to take care of us, and to bring us to the right direction. And when you look at each of these four examples, the first example, the person is lost. He doesn't know where to go. And a lot of times, you know, we get lost in our own way. We lack knowledge. And people think that they need to learn more about God, right? To experience his love. But no, that's not true. Okay? Ignorance is not a barrier to experiencing God's love. In the second example, the people who are in darkness, it's through their disobedience and rebelliousness. Right? Even our rebellious and heart and disobedience cannot keep God's love away. And in the third example, even our foolishness and our iniquities, the foolish choices we make that gets us sick in our hearts. Let me share this example of foolish. You know, I have so many foolish examples in my life I want to share with all of you. and this relates to becoming sick. I don't know if you guys have ever been heartbroken, right? And don't date until you're prepared to be heartbroken, right? I don't know if you guys experienced that. My first girlfriend, I met in my second year of college. So it took me a while, right? I mean, these days, you know, my younger brother was dating when he was in junior high, right? And it was this, and so I don't know what it, I was like, man, I'm better looking. Smart. What is it? I guess he has the charisma. I don't know what he has. But he's just nicer. He has a better heart. Anyway, so I finally meet this girl, and I'm just in love with her, right? I wanted to marry her. I proposed, actually. I proposed to her. She was a freshman in college. Right? Foolish. But hey, love conquers all, right? We can do anything. Especially when you're 21, right? When you guys are like 20s, you think you can do everything. Well, be thankful for that. But so, and I told her and wanted to marry her. And we were at a retreat. And she didn't give me an answer. And I kept on pressuring her. And my plan was, okay, God had called me, you know, to be a minister, and I'm going to be a pastor, so you're going to be my samunim, my wife, right? And then we're going to do great ministry together. Man, don't you love that? I'm like, let me think about that one. I'll get back to you, okay? Life as a samunim, I don't think so. But now, I was serving as a praise leader for a youth group, and there was a chodusami and a samunim. And the samunim, the pastor's wife was in charge of the youth group, and Chalusanim, the minister, was in charge of the college. And I told the minister, Chalusanim, give me the youth group. I'll take him to Haichi, you know, they'll never been. He said, no, you're not ready? Wait, right? And so I was like, what? You're denying me? You know, you got a talented youth minister like me, you're denying me. And then coupled with that, and my girlfriend at the time not giving me an answer, you know, like accepting my proposal to marry her, the pride got the best of me. And right, fine. And so what I did was I broke up with my girlfriend during the retreat, right there and then, because of the pride, you know, foolish. So much foolishness. And what had happened was, I broke up with her because of the pride, you know, not because she did something wrong or I found something wrong with her. She was really still in my heart. In my pride, in my mind, I let her go, but in my heart, she was still there. And the longing was still there, right? And after we broke up, I tried to go back to her. And in my prideful self, I was like, oh, of course she would receive me back. No. She would not receive me back. She wouldn't even listen to me. She wouldn't even answer my call, right? And in that desperation, that the sickness, right, that your heart goes into when you face a rejection, and when the longing in your heart cannot be fulfilled by any person, right? I don't want any of you guys to go through that. But when you do, God, He steps in, and He's able to heal us, despite our foolishness, you know, despite our foolishness. You know, in the end, God did, in time, you know, He was able to restore my heart and help me to learn many things through that. And lastly, God's love is eternal and powerful. Doesn't matter what circumstances you may be in that you can't handle on your own. The example that the psalmist gives, he's a merchant. And he's traveling back and forth in the seas a lot. You know? So this is a business kind of an example. You know, when you're in the marketplace, when you're working, you'll find situations, economic situations, I don't know, some difficulties you may face that you cannot handle on your own. But God and His love is able to overcome that. How? How do we experience that? Okay? How do we experience His eternal good love in our lives? Okay? And when we look in this four examples, what does it say? All four times, it's exactly the same. All the four says, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. They cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. And I think what the psalmist wants us to realize is that there are going to be difficult circumstances in life. The Israelites, God saved them from Egypt, from slavery. That corresponds to Jesus Christ saving us from the slavery of sin in our lives. And He brought them into the promised land. Okay? And that corresponds to us being brought into the kingdom of God in His church. But they said, and they were kicked out, right? So there's going to be circumstances in our lives, right? And what carried us to where we are now is God's grace. Okay? Where you are now, whatever good place you're in now, and where we are as a church now, where the English ministry is now, God's been there step by. It's by God's love and grace that we're here now. And the more important thing, it's God's grace that's going to carry us into the future. It's not our abilities. It's not our wisdom. It's not our knowledge, right? It's not how good we are, how sinless we are, how good we are before God that's going to carry us into the future. It's God's love. The psalmist is saying, you're going to face these. You faced these situations before. You're going to face it again. Don't depend on yourself. Don't depend on your own abilities. Allow God to come into your life. Let me ask you guys a question. Do you have room in your life for God? Or are you in control 100%? Are you the only one driving, right? And in this modern day and age, there's very little that we need to depend on God for, right? We get our food from co-op. All you need is money, right? And we're so self-sufficient. And so the psalmist is saying, have room for God in your life. You know, when you run into trouble, cry out to God. You know, do you turn to God, you know? Or do you try to handle everything on your own? You know, you try to figure out yourself, in your mind, okay, if I do this, things will work out, right? The psalmist is saying, it's God who brought you here, and it's God who's going to give you a future. Consider the love of God, His goodness, His good plan for you, right? And His power, His eternal, unchanging love of God. And so he ends, verse 43. John, can you turn there? Is there? Let the one who is wise heed these things and ponder the loving deeds of the Lord. That's the whole point of the psalmist. Whoever is wise, ponder the loving deeds of the Lord. I don't know if all of you have experienced the saving love of God, exhaling. And anyways, ponder the saving love of God in the midst of this hail. Hallelujah. Yeah. But make room in your heart for God. Okay? Don't try to handle everything on your own. It's His loving grace that brought you here, and it's His loving grace that's going to bring you into the future. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father God,